Welcome to worship in the Unitarian Universalist Church of Charlotte. There is a prayer that was written for the dedication of a congregational building by Unitarian Universalist minister Eileen Carpelli, and it goes like this. Out of wood and stone, out of dream and sacrifice, the people build a home. Out of the work of their hands and hearts and minds, the people fashion a symbol and a reality. May this house be truly a place of meeting, meeting in warmth and joy and openness, meeting in courage and love and trust. May all who enter here trust one another so surely that they may share the deep fires that burst into anger as much as the sweet spring waters that swell into laughter, the slow erosion of wounded tears as much as the soaring song. May the rain fall lightly on this house, and the sun shine warmly. The winds blow softly and bless it as a place of joy and peace. With this as our guiding prayer this morning, we give thanks for one another's presence and for this hour spent together, set apart. As we prepare to sing our opening song, would you please turn to someone next to you and wish them well?
Our chalice lighting words come from the writings of Jennifer Leota Gray. We come together every week, bound not by a creed or a mutual desire to please one God or many gods, yet we are drawn together by a belief that how we are in the world, who we are together, matters. We light this chalice together in that knowledge that love, not fear, can change this world.
Thank you.
Our reading this morning comes from Bound in Covenant, an article written by Unitarian Universalist minister Victoria Safford. We welcome our people each week saying, "This is a congregation bound not by creed, but by covenant, each to each and each to all, by what theologian Rebecca Parker calls freely chosen and life-sustaining interdependence. The central question for us is not, what do we believe, but more, what do we believe in? To what larger love, to what people, principles, values, and dreams shall we be committed? To whom or to what are we accountable? In a tradition that is so deeply steeped in individualism, it becomes a spiritual practice for each of us to ask, not once and for all, but again and again, even over 90 years of life, how do I decide which beautiful, clumsy, and imperfect institutions will carry and hold my name, hand, and heart? The life of the Spirit is indeed solitary, but our answers to these questions call us to speak, call us to live in the plural."
Thank you.
In one of the many sacred stories about the founder of Hasidic Judaism, a rabbi known by the title Baal Shem, we find the Baal Shem trying to pray the moon out from behind a thick cloud. In Judaism, the passing of time is measured by the cycles of the moon. Each month ends when the moon goes dark in the sky. And in some traditions, the end of each month is accompanied by a time of fasting and penitence, and thus the appearance of a tiny sliver of moon the next night marks the beginning of a new month and is cause for celebration. In this tale, the Baal Shem sat worrying over the persistent darkness of the sky, knowing that he could not say the required blessing of the moon until it appeared. Time would stand still. All that waited for renewal and celebration would go on waiting. The Hasidim, the community of faithful who followed the Baal Shem's teachings, didn't know that their beloved leader sat alone in his room, distraught over his inability to bring about the required miracle. Not knowing the Baal Shem's grief, the community joined hands in the front room of his house and began to dance, celebrating the promise of the month ahead. As Martin Buber puts it in his retelling of the story, when their holy delight mounted higher and higher, they invaded the Baal Shem's chamber, still dancing. Overwhelmed by their own frenzy of happiness, they took him by the hands as he sat there sunk in gloom, and drew him into the round. At this moment, someone called outside. The night had suddenly grown light. In greater radiance than ever before, the moon curved on a flawless sky. Even one as wise and faithful as the Baal Shem could not call forth the moon by himself. Even one as persistent and powerful as he could not carry the experience of renewal and celebration alone. Religious community provides glimpses of the sublime that we cannot manage alone. At its best, religious community makes the transcendent tangible. Queer feminist theologian Carter Hayward describes the transcendent as the eternally creative source of our relational power, our common strength. In community, something happens between our individual lives. There's a kind of pull, a tension that holds us together, each to each, and each to all, as Victoria Safford put it. I have been part of this congregation, this religious community, for about 7 months now. And one of my greatest joys still since arriving is trying to get to know each of you individually. And at the same time as someone new among us, I'm still trying to piece together who we are as a collective, our history, where we've been and who we are now, what commitments have been carried forward in this community since it was started. And in part, you begin to get a sense of a community by hearing some of its stories. These stories sometimes show the values and personality of a congregation. And this week I heard one such story from someone who's been a member here for over 40 years. A story that gave me another glimpse into the nature of this community that I'm joining my life to. In the early 1980s, this congregation committed to raising the money and patience to undergo an extensive construction project, culminating with the addition of the sanctuary we're sitting in now. And I heard this week how congregants had poured themselves into raising enough money for the addition and renovations. But when all was said and done, there wasn't enough left over for the landscaping. And the updated building was surrounded by this unsettled, tilled up earth from the tumult of construction. But somehow or other, the word went out to members of the congregation that they should gather here on an upcoming Saturday and bring flowers or other plants with them to donate to the grounds. And lo and behold, more than enough people showed up with their plants in hand. A few took charge as to where these plants and those plants should go, and everyone dug and planted and watered together. And by the end of the day, new things were growing in the once unsettled ground. And it was easier to believe that this newly renovated building was a place that could house the day in and day out of community. People showed up that Saturday to nurture a collective experience, the coming together of our lives. I imagine this was one of many times when people of this congregation came together to strengthen and sustain the kind of community that outlives particular individuals or moments in time. I imagine that Saturday spent digging and planting was one of many moments when our members worked to strengthen a collective experience that would go on to hold people some of them would never know. I know that this is just one story from our collective past, but it solidifies a bit more for me, something I was beginning to suspect about our congregation. From watching how you prepare for a reception following the memorial service of a member, filling Freeman Hall with flowers and meals that you cooked in your own homes. Something I was beginning to suspect from taking part in conversations with you after an intense evening of class during the week, or after witnessing the moving vulnerability of members standing up to share their spiritual commitments with fellow congregants, to speak aloud what they're giving their hearts to. This story of communal landscaping, of coming together to make up the difference, of replanting, putting down roots in unsettled ground, feels telling to me. It's additional evidence that at our core, there is a covenant of presence. Enough people willing to come together when the way is clear and when the way is uncertain. Being present not only when we feel ready or prepared, but coming together when we feel doubtful and bruised too. As Eileen Carpelli says, may this house be truly a place of meeting. Meeting one with another in warmth and joy and openness. Meeting one with another in courage and love. So that all who enter here trust one another so surely that they dare to share the deep fires that burst into anger, as much as the sweet spring waters that swell into laughter, the slow erosion of wounded tears, as much as the soaring song. When we here learn of a pain or joy that is too much for an individual to carry alone, we speak in prayer of a transcendent love, a larger love that holds them. It's our covenant of presence that makes this transcendent love something we can touch and hear and talk to. Our presence in community is how we take hands and pull one another out of our gloom. And through the dance, remember that no one person is able to carry us through the night alone. I'm so looking forward to learning more of the stories from our past. I'm so looking forward to witnessing and participating in the nurturing of loving community here, continuing to learn what so many of you already know, that when we are present with one another, not once, but again and again, when we allow a loving and imperfect community to carry and hold our name, our heart, and our hand, when we speak and live in the plural, we make transcendent love real. Blessed be. Amen.
This song was written by Tim Lamond, a longtime member of this congregation, now of blessed memory, who passed away in 2011. Tim had music in his soul and taught so many of us, by example, how music has the power to heal, to inspire, and to bring people together. I had a chance over the weekend to exchange some emails with Lori Reed, Tim's wife, and I asked her about sort of the circumstances under which he wrote this song, what inspired him, and she offered some interesting and moving perspective. As a songwriter, Tim sang directly from his own heart and own experience, Lori stressed. He and Lori established a network of friends and family, including their own children and others, who gathered regularly at their home to sing. And this song captures the essence of what creating community came to mean to Tim personally. It also calls all of us to make that effort to reach out, even when, or especially when, that's hard to do. When we let go of our personal struggles, even for a time, and work to connect with others, we can create something beautiful. We can create a community of love. There are times in our lives when we all feel sad and lonely, and it's hard to go on when it seems like no one will understand. But look around and you'll see
Welcome to today's service, whether you're in this room or in our alternative worship space in the Bernstein Room, or watching this service by way of our live stream, or viewing an archive video of this service. We are honored, as always, to have guests with us today. Our members would love to greet you following the service, so that we might do so. If you are visiting, please raise your hand and keep it up. Well, that's good. Members, please take note of the guests seated near you and after the service, invite them to join you for coffee and conversation in Freeman Hall. Should it enhance your experience of future services, you can find both a large print order of service and a personal hearing assistance device on the table at the entrance to the sanctuary. If you'd like to learn more about us, please fill out a yellow card and place your completed card in an offering basket when they are passed later in the service. Members with a life event to share can do so on the reverse side of that card. You will find them, along with offering envelopes, on the clipboards at the end of the row. Please begin passing them down now. Some returning visitors may be interested in learning more about how to become a member. If so, talk with our membership coordinator, Kelly Green. Her contact information is on the back of your order of service. Again, to each of you, welcome. My name is Tom Nunnenkamp, and I walked into this church the first time over 47 years ago, in February of 1971. That was the first Sunday after my discharge from the United States Army. What that 23-year-old found was a loving, socially active, if somewhat dysfunctional, community. My earlier reading from UU Minister Victoria Safford included the line, "How do I decide which beautiful, clumsy, and imperfect institutions will carry and hold my name, hand, and heart?" A few years after walking in that first time, I arrived one Sunday in what is now Freeman Hall, only to find that there was a bulletin board set up in front. It was later explained by our new treasurer, Darwin Smith, who was then comptroller of what was then North Carolina National Bank, that we were effectively bankrupt. The congregation had no idea our financial situation was quite so bleak. The church was months behind in paying mortgage, utilities, and insurance. Would we even be able to hold services the following Sunday? But with Darwin and his wife Myra's leadership, bills were pinned to that bulletin board in front of the seated congregation, and one by one, people came up and as groups paid those bills. That community commitment confirmed to me that I had indeed chosen an institution that I was willing to carry and hold my name, my hand, my heart. I was recently introduced to an excerpt from an article written by United Church of Christ minister Lillian Daniel. She writes, "Being privately spiritual just doesn't interest me. There's nothing challenging about having deep thoughts all by oneself. What is interesting is doing this work in community, where other people might call you on stuff, or heaven forbid, disagree with you." As I read and reread those words, I realized that they contained another reason for my deep attachment to this community. I've been in a men's group at this church that has met regularly for over 25 years. My wife Lib and I have close friendships here that have endured for decades. These loving relationships are ones where, as Lillian Daniel says, people might call you on stuff, or heaven forbid, disagree with you. There is tremendous power in having relationships where disagreements can take place and yet the loving bond is still intact. We have that place here. We stand on the shoulders of imperfect people who forged community that could withstand financial crisis and deep disagreements on how best to address the social ills of their times. May we be worthy to carry their mantle now as a community committed to cultural, racial, economic, and environmental justice.
If you would like to learn more about ways to engage with this community, I invite you to read through the back of your order of service, explore our website, and subscribe to our weekly e-newsletter, Currents. If you are visiting today, after the service, we hope you'll grab a cup of coffee in Freeman Hall and then head downstairs to the conference room for an informal conversation with one of our longtime members who can answer some of your questions and help you begin to find your way into the life of this congregation. After the service, our high school youth will be hosting a fundraiser brunch in Freeman Hall. Proceeds will contribute to next year's coming of age program and Unitarian Universalist heritage trip to Boston. Families with children in fifth grade or younger, and we really do mean babies and toddlers too, plus siblings of all ages, join us in Freeman Hall this Wednesday, December 5th, to explore how Unitarian Universalist families might make meaning together over the holiday season. We take a moment now to hold in our thoughts the larger human community. People around the world, in our country, our state, and our city. We're sending love to all those who live in fear, those who are hungry, those who are grieving. We join our hearts with the larger human community. Just as we join our hearts as a congregation as well, our community that gathers again and again to hold what is too much for any individual to hold alone. We hold in love Mary Ann Lawler and her husband Neil as Mary Ann recovers from surgery. Julie, Roy, and Eric Smith are in our prayers as they grieve the death of Julie's father. We hold in our hearts Helen Fowler and Lincoln Baxter as they grieve the death of Helen's father. We hold in love Lorna Burns and Wright Thompson and their children Micah and Bryn as they grieve the death of Lorna's father, Alan Burns. In our deep sorrow, we hold in love and prayers Simone and Dick Lake as they mourn the death of their daughter, Sarah Lake Wilkerson, and send love to Sarah's three siblings, among them our member, Suzanne Lake, as they mourn the loss of their sister. And in deep sorrow, we hold in love our members, Kathy Height, her husband, Jim Morrill, and their son, Max, in the death of Kathy and Jim's son, Will. Will Morrill attended our open door school and participated in our children and youth religious education program, including our coming of age experience. And there will be a service here on Wednesday at 2 p.m., led by our minister, Jay Leach, to celebrate Will's life. If you too are carrying a joy or a sorrow that is too much to carry alone, you are invited later in the service, visitors and members alike, when the offering baskets are being passed and music is being played, you can come forward and light a candle in silence. Our Jewish neighbors will begin the celebration of Hanukkah this evening at sundown, lighting candles in the dark. And this prayer, adapted from Moshe Davis and Victor Ratner, invites us to reflect on the wisdom that the Festival of Lights has to offer for all of us. Would you be with me in meditation and prayer? A candle is a small thing, but one candle can light another and see how its own light increases as a candle gives its flame to the other. You are such a light. Light is the power to dispel darkness. We have this power to move back the darkness with the light created when one mind illuminates another, when one heart kindles another, when one being strengthens another. To do our daily part to increase this light, we must remember that a candle alone is a small thing. A person alone is a small thing. A nation alone is a small thing, but we are not alone. To be strong, the strong must serve. In lighting the Hanukkah candles in the home and in the heart, may we honor the eternal bridge of light which reaches from creation itself to the radiant spirit of freedom. Amen.
Our congregation is primarily supported by the generous annual pledges of our members. However, the weekly passing of the offering basket is a ritual of generosity. It gives us all the opportunity to make a shared, tangible acknowledgement of the importance of our coming together in community. The ushers will now pass the basket.
Your presence here is a blessing. Whatever you are carrying, whatever joy and pain you have known, your presence here is a blessing to the good of the whole. Please be seated. And we encourage you to sing the chorus of our closing music with us.
Here's the baby time.